Your data is really expensive. How much? Well, consider, according to IBM's annual cost of a data breach survey, we found it's on the order of $5 million every time there's a data breach. That's the average. So if you're looking at a bell curve, that's the stuff here. That means there are plenty more that are actually a lot more than that. Well, in this video, we're going to take a look at what were the findings from that survey, and we've run it many years, and we're going to take a look at some lessons learned from real-world data breaches, and ultimately some recommendations of what you can do to guard against this and mitigate this cost. Data is the lifeblood of a modern enterprise. If you lose it, you lose your competitive edge. You could, for instance, lose your intellectual property. You could lose things like your company's reputation. And ultimately, you can lose these folks, customers. You don't want to lose those. So it's really important that we not lose that information, that we're able to maintain that and keep it secure. So that's why IBM has conducted, for the 19th year in a row, the cost of a data breach survey. And we produce a report, which you can take a look at in detail and see those findings. In this video, we're going to take a look at what some of those major findings were. And to give you an idea of the methodology behind this, they actually went out and talked to about 600 organizations and interviewed in the range of 3,500 people. So there was a lot of work that goes behind this, a lot of data. I don't want you to think that they just went and cherry-picked a few people. These are all people that experienced real-world data breaches. So when we talk about what the survey tells us a lot. It tells us what real-world data breaches actually were like. Okay, let's take a look at the costs and see what the trend has been over time. If we look at the last number of years, you can see generally the trend is working its way up. Not a huge surprise. Everything's more expensive. It turns out your data is as well. Last year, we were at about $4.5 million on average for a data breach worldwide. Well, this year, I have some bad news to report. We're now at about $4.9 million, which is an increase of around 10%. So that's not what we want to see happen. We'd like to see these costs going down, but they're not. They're continuing to increase. Oh, and by the way, if you think that's a tolerable number, if you're in the U.S., you can pretty much multiply it by two, because the U.S. numbers are about twice this. So again, not really what we want to see. We'd like to see these numbers come down. We'll talk later in the video about what we could be doing that will actually contribute to that. But let's also take a look at this from an industry perspective. Were there certain industries that did better or did worse, or that it was more expensive or less expensive based upon if their data was breached? Well, we'll start off with the first. These are the top five, by the way. There are others that were lower than this. But if we're looking at just the top five, at $5.3 million, that's where you're going to see the energy sector. At $5.5 million, just a little bit up from that, that's where you're going to see the technology sector. And then up from that, the industrials. Industrial area, $5.6 million per data breach. Then, as we're building, financial comes in at 6.1. Now, who was the winner? Well, I don't know, maybe loser. But if you look at this, way up here at 9.8 is where the healthcare industry came in. So information in that space is really important, and it's reflected in the numbers here. So what were the challenges that contributed to those kinds of numbers? Well, it turns out staffing shortage was a big one. That is, we've got these folks on board, but how about the others that we don't have? It turns out that a lot of organizations, in fact, more than 50% reported staffing shortages as one of the major challenges that was contributing. That number is up 26% from last year's report. So that's not trending in the right direction. Another one, let me ask you, do you know where your data is? Really? Well, you might know about this, but this other stuff, the shadow data, where somebody has made a copy of the data, or maybe they created new data and didn't tell you about it, and yet it's still sensitive. And if this gets compromised, we're still in trouble. Well, that's an area that also turned out to be a challenge. And in fact, this area is not going to get better, I expect. When we start adding AI into the picture, we're going to see AI models that will be shadow versions as well, and we're going to need to discover those also. So keep an eye on that. How about some of the causes? The attack vectors, the top two were in fact the same as they were last year. It was phishing, and it was credential theft. And in fact, if you think about it, a lot of phishing attacks are really about stealing credentials anyway. So very similar that those two things came out number one. A lot of other things that contributed, and you can look at the report to see the details of other aspects that were exploited in this, but these were the two that stood out. So if we want to make a big difference, obviously we need to focus here. And what is that? That's all about identity and access management, at least the credential part. Okay, let's take a look at one other aspect where we actually saw a little bit of good news, but it wasn't a great deal. Nothing really to write home about. Mean time to identify. How long does it take for you to figure out that the bad guy is in your system? That number has remained about the same for the last decade or so. It's about 200 days, which is way too long. Mean time to contain, actually get the problem taken care of. That has remained at about 70 days. So you look at those together and you end up with about 270 days, which is about 3/4 of a year. That is way too long. And again, that's the average. That means that there are a number of these that are taking well beyond that, maybe more than a year before we realize and get the situation contained. That's an intolerable situation, I think, going forward. And we found that if in fact the cause of the data breach was dealing with these identity credentials, that the number was actually even higher. It was 292 days. So let's focus on these kinds of things. And we'll take a look at some recommendations. Okay, enough of the gloom and doom. How about a little sunshine? What can we do to improve the cost of a data breach? Well, it turns out there were three things that the report told us based upon the real world data that were lessons learned that told us these are the things that actually contribute to the cost of a data breach and make it worse. And I'm going to give you five things and then even a few bonus topics that will decrease the cost of a data breach. So stay through till the end. Number one on this list was complexity. Complexity of the security system. It turns out complexity is the enemy of security. So whatever we can do to follow what I refer to as the KISS principle, keep it simple, stupid, that's going to be to your benefit. Make the system as simple as you possibly can. Now, let me give you an example of what I mean by that. Let's take a look at in the identity and access management space. What typically happens in organizations is we will have a different identity management system, directory, what have you, for each application, or at least for a few different applications, different OSs, and so forth. So that means I need an administrator for each one of these. That is not following the KISS principle. This would be simplifying, is if I put a layer here for identity and access management above, then I can have an administrator up here who administers all of these systems through a central console, through a common interface. And then maybe I don't need as much of this. I can use those people on other areas where their skills are best utilized. The same thing applies in the data space. So if I've got data security, well, I'm securing each one of these databases using the native access control capabilities. But what if instead, I use a common data security layer, then I could have an administrator up here who administers through that, and then it pushes all these out. And again, it allows me to reduce the impact that I have where I don't have enough staffing, and it gives me a more consistent, more simple interface. So keep that in mind as a possibility. What else? Well, the skills shortage. I mentioned that earlier. Turns out the skills shortage is causing the cost of a data breach to go up. So again, if I can do things here, it mitigates a lot of what would be otherwise a particular issue. Now, in a perfect world, I just hire more people. But we're not going to be able to hire all the people we want. We don't have the money for it, and there are not enough skilled people out there. So what else could we do? Well, let's see what AI and automation can do for us. More on that later. Another thing that contributed to the cost of a data breach in a big way was third-party issues. That is, when you connect your system into others, you also inherit some of the risk that goes along with their systems. You might do a perfect job of security, but if they don't, you get to now downstream bring in all of the problems that they have as well. And we found that was a major area that was contributing to cost. So what should you do about that? Well, trust but verify. I need to go in and make sure that everything they're doing that they said that they're doing in their security, as much as possible, I need to verify that that's the case. Make sure that their policies match my policies, their expectations, my expectations, and so forth. So that's a big area as well. And one of those third parties could, in fact, be your cloud provider, as an example. All right, what are the things that we could do that will actually contribute to bringing the cost down? Those are the things that contributed to making it go up. So we'll look at the flip side of this. Well, number one on the list was employee training. This was maybe a little bit of a surprise for a lot of people, but training your employees so that they become a part of your security system and not another weak link can make a big difference. What else could we do? Well, we could also, as I said before, use more AI and automation. And what the report showed us is that organizations that do that were able to save in the order of $2.2 million on the cost of a data breach. That's significant. If the overall number is about 4.9 and you're able to save this much by doing any particular thing, that's a big difference. So that's a $2.2 million savings by organizations that had extensive use of automation and AI as compared to those who didn't. So this is a big one that can make a huge difference, as we see. Having a good security information and event management system in place is important. You can't secure what you can't see. So you need a system that monitors all the different things that would be out there. So a good SIM helps you with that. Incident response planning. That is knowing in advance where the fire extinguisher is so that you're not searching for it at the moment that your hair is on fire. That's the way you want to approach this. So you want to plan out what all the contingencies would be and make sure that you have the plans, the tools, the processes all in place and you know how to do it in that moment when it occurs. And then, obviously, if we're talking about data that is sensitive, encrypt it. That way, if someone does get into your system and copies that out, well, they can only do so much with it because it's encrypted. Hopefully, you've encrypted it well, and it will still be covered for you. So those are the kinds of things that make a lot of sense for us to do, but what else could we do? I told you I would give you some bonus topics in this space as well. Well, some other things that turned out to be very important. I mentioned earlier that credentials were a big part of what was causing these data breaches to occur. So whatever I can do to improve my identity and access management would make a big difference. What kinds of things could we do there? Well, how about multi-factor authentication? How about using passkeys? Those are the kinds of things that if I use passkeys, no one can steal my password because I don't have one in the first place. And if you say, well, they'll just steal a passkey, take a look at the video I did on passkeys and you'll see how much more difficult something like that would in fact be. What are some other things you could do? How about data security posture management? Know where all your data is, discover it all, especially in cloud instances, that shadow data that I mentioned earlier. We need to know where it is or we can't secure it. Also, I want to be able to make sure that I have the controls in place once I've found it and that we've automatically verified that and we have a dashboard that shows us all of that visibility. Very important. And then ultimately, leverage law enforcement. It turns out that the organizations that did, that two-thirds of them that brought in law enforcement in a ransomware case paid, are you ready for this? $0 in ransom. That's a nice number. So it's not a guarantee, but it certainly puts the odds in your favor. If you have a ransomware attack, this reduces the likelihood. And it turned out, it also reduced the cost of a data breach. So there you go. The cost of a data breach, unsurprisingly, is up. But the good news is there are some things you can do to lessen those costs and lessen your risk. Take a look at the full report and you can learn more. If you like this video and want to see more like it, please like and subscribe. If you have any questions or want to share your thoughts about this topic, please leave a comment below.